gave me a scripture, which is the one that I'm going to read. And I've noticed that he's been giving me a lot of scriptures out of Ezekiel. So I thought, a few weeks ago, I talked about how my brother and I had a conversation, that specific book came up. And I thought it was for him to read it. But now I'm starting to think that I am the one that's supposed to do it. So I've been doing that at home and whenever I have some time to start reading. But this is the testimony. There's this couple that I know from many, many years ago. I went to music school with both of them. And they have a child, their youngest one, that right now has cancer. And he's either going to turn 5 or recently turned 5. So they've been in and out of St. Jude in Tennessee. So a few weeks ago, they went back to Puerto Rico to be there, but he got sick again. So they had to take him back to the hospital. His condition is so critical that he cannot take just your regular commercial flight. He needs to be transported in an air ambulance. Thing is, the cost of that was $29,000 just to take him from San Juan to Tennessee. So a lot of people got together and started praying, and also they started this fundraising. And as soon as it was announced, in a matter of hours, they raised $29,000 and then more. So they were getting everything ready to take their son to the hospital, but they needed to let the company that operated the plane by 7 p.m. that day that they were gonna go with the trip. So they were waiting for this state agency back home to come through with some paperwork for the approval of the flight. It was 7 p.m. and they still didn't had an answer yet. In addition to that, they needed to pay the $29,000 in cash before the flight left. So the guy calls the flight company and says, listen, I haven't heard from this agency, so I think we're gonna have to postpone this flight for a couple of days. All right, we'll just wait for you to call us back. At 7:30 that same day, they called him back and said, hey, we just got a call from this state agency that you were waiting for, and they came through with the paperwork. And they also told us that they were gonna cover the $29,000. So not only that, they're paying for that. They were also able to raise the money with people, you know, the goodness of their heart and all that. So now they have that additional amount of money they can use for kids' treatment. So when I saw that, I'm like, you know, when God comes through, he comes through. So I want to read this scripture now, and it's Ezekiel chapter 34. The Lord gave me specific verses out of that, but I want to read from the beginning of the chapter up to the point where the Lord gave me, because I think this applies to us, and this is something that we have to keep reminding ourselves of. And this is what it says. The word of the Lord came to me. Son of man, prophesy against the shepherd of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, even to the shepherds, thus says the Lord God, O shepherds of Israel, who have been feeding yourselves, should not shepherds feed the sheep? You eat the fat, you clothe yourselves with the wool, you slaughter the fat ones, but you do not feed the sheep. The weak you have not strengthened, the sick you have not healed, the injured you have not bound up, the strayed you have not brought back, the lost you have not sought, and with force and harshness you have ruled them. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd, and they became food for all the wild beasts. My sheep were scattered. They wandered over all the mountains and on every high hill. My sheep were scattered over all the face of the earth, with none to search or seek for them. Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. As I live, declares the Lord God, surely because my sheep have become a prey, and my sheep have become food for all the wild beasts, since there was no shepherd, and because my shepherds have not searched for my sheep, but the shepherds have fed themselves and have not fed my sheep. Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against the shepherds, and I will require my sheep at their hand and put a stop to their feeding the sheep. No longer shall the shepherds feed themselves. I will rescue my sheep from their mouths, that they may not be food for them. And these are the verses that the Lord gave me. For thus says the Lord God, behold, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out. As the shepherd seeks out his flock when he is among his sheep that have been scattered, so will I seek out my sheep. And I will rescue them from all the places where they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. And I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries, and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, by the ravines, and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them with good pasture, and on the mountain heights of Israel shall be their grazing land. There they shall lie down in good grazing land, and on rich pasture they shall feed on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I myself will make them lie down, declares the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed, and I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak, and the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them in justice. First time that I read this was during house of prayer a few weeks ago. And the first thing that I saw when I read those specific verses was me. I wasn't in the darkest place a person could possibly get, but I was lost. I wasn't seeing clearly, but praise God, He put someone in my life to show me who He is that brought me here. We are all called to do that for someone else, because we are instruments of God to bring those sheep that are scattered, that are lost, back to Him, so we can all enjoy everything that He has promised us.
Amen.
With that, anyone has any testimony they want to share or a prayer request? Yes, James.
I mean, I usually like to have the next is.
just ask God to touch him. But we don't know that God's got this other person. It may be at a filling station. Maybe, you know, God bless you, or the Lord asked me to pray for you, or because we don't know who prayed for us before we became Christians. That could be somebody clear across the world. And we just want to be obedient. When God puts, you know, somebody on our heart to pray for them, please pray for them or call them or write them a letter and tell them God loves them, because we don't know what they're going through. I teach at school, and I think the best part of teaching, I teach semi-driving, and sometimes I'm going to student one-on-one in the truck, and they feel really comfortable. There's nobody else in there, and they feel comfortable to open up about the things that's going on in their lives. You know, I've had a lot of prayer requests, and some of them ask, would you pray for me, because my family's going through this. And I think it's just a great opportunity to realize, you know, yes, I'm going to agree with you. I'm going to pray with you. Because, you know, God, he understands our heart. Sometimes you can't even get the words out when you pray. Sometimes it's just crying. And like I was reading Psalm 56, you know, this I know God is for me. You know, and just to realize that God is for you. He's on your side. And he wants the best for you. You know, and our job, I always feel our job as a Christian, as a believer, is just to trust God. You know, and sometimes that's what frustrates us, because we want God, how come you're not moving now? And he just says, you know, like the new term, I got it. You know, God's got your back. He's got it. He's telling us all the time, I got it. I can take care of it. Look, I created the whole world. You know, before you was in mom's belly, I knew you. Don't you think I can take care of you? If I created you, I know your personality. I know how much money you need. I know about your bills. I know about your cars. I know about your kids. I knew about your kids before you knew about your kids. Okay? So you think I can take care of you? The answer is yes. And I think that's what we need to come. It's just trust in God. Leave it in his hands.
Amen.
Bless the Lord.
That opened the door. Thank you. Something that I went to a funeral Friday morning of a prominent lady here in Des Moines that died of Alzheimer's. And, you know, that is a horrible, debilitating, terrible. It ends in death. But you lose everything. It reminded me when the devil came to kill, steal, and destroy, when he deals with God's people, sometimes he can't destroy them. And he can't kill them. But he steals from them. And I'll tell you what, my brothers and I began to talk about that on the way when we left. And with Robin Williams, you know, who would have ever imagined that this guy seemingly had the world by the tail and was so down that he ended up taking his own life. We came up with this, that the same spirits that Jesus dealt with are still in the world today. They are the ones that kill, steal, and destroy. And God's people, we can believe for salvation, but we can't believe for all the other things. And it reminds me when Jesus stood on the Mount of Olives and he told Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, I would have gathered your mother hen, gathered her chicks, but you would not. And I think so many times, that's what he's telling us. If you just will hang on to me, none of that stuff can get a hold of you. But if you crack, if you think that, well, that happens to people. Cancer happens to people. I want to be, you know, reality. But the reality is that in Christ, none of those things can happen unless we let our guard down and believe a lie. See, we think it's all about salvation, and that, of course, is the main thing. But after that, the abundant life comes from believing him in totality.
Amen.
He takes care of everything.
Amen.
He said 1,000 will fall to one hand, 10,000 at except when we see these things, look up for our redemption draweth nigh. All the things we've thought about, all the battles we fight, they are in Christ. We have to turn to Him. We have to hide ourselves in Him. He's the cleft in the rock. He's the place we get into. I'll tell you, I battle things all the time. You know, I things are all mental, but that's where Satan dwells. He dwells in that area. He comes against us mentally.
just roaming around seeking weak people like myself, and I get down in the flesh and I start using my own brain and not walking in the spirit and talking the words of God, well, it's how easy of a target am I? I don't want to be an easy target. Withstand him, be firm in faith, against his onset, rooted, established, strong, immovable, and determined, knowing the same sufferings are appointed to your whole brotherhood, the whole body of Christ, throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his own eternal glory in Christ Jesus, will himself complete and make you what you ought to be. Establish and ground your securely and strengthen and settle you. To him the dominion, the power forever and ever. Amen. And that is the truth. It's absolutely true. All the things we've heard this morning, yes, we're going to be attacked. And I have something that I am tired of dealing with in my life. And I'm certain that my wife is very tired of dealing with it in her life. And the society that we live in dictates that you shouldn't talk about these kind of things. Well, if I don't, then how am I truly going to get a point across? You don't have to have all the graphic details in order to be able to pray correctly for a situation, but I am proclaiming right now, and I hope that you all will the same with me, is that this attack has got to stop, and it has to stop in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
Yes.
There is no other name given to us whereby we must be saved. There's no name above his name, and I'm proclaiming it in the name of Jesus. My finances are absolute crapola, and I don't believe for a second that God wants my finances to be crapola. I don't believe it. I just don't. And I'm not going to live in that realm, that world anymore. And I proclaim victory in the name of Jesus, and I just ask you all just to pray and bind and stand with me as we stand with Mike this morning. And, you know, as we lift up the leaders of our church, our pastor, what an awesome dude.
Yeah.
I mean, absolutely awesome. Man after God's own heart. And I'm glad to be a part of a body of Christ that looks around and sees in each other's eyes and sees in each other's spirit that, yeah, man, I can't find anything to go against it. It's right there in the Word of God.
Right.
And I can stand behind that. Amen?
Amen.
The Lord's awesome. Thank you.
All right, well, let's stand. Let's put all of those burdens in the Lord's hands. Father, we thank you for bringing us together today, Lord, being your presence, Father. We put all of these burdens that we carry, Lord, in your hands, and we want to take your burdens, which is easy. Father, we ask that you heal all of those that are in fear of you, that you bring restoration to all of those who need restoration, Lord. Your sheep are lost in this world. Seek them and bring them, Lord, to you. To bring the restoration back to you. We know that you're Would you take the offering, please? Donna, can you say the blessing? Thank you.
Lord, we just come to you this morning, Lord Father, that you will just be with each and every one of us as we rejoice in your mighty and glorious name, Father. We just thank you for everything that you do for each and every one of us, Lord, and that you will just be with us like you promised, Lord, that you will never leave us or forsake us, Lord. And we are so grateful to be children of yours, Lord Father. And we just thank you very much for all you do. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's worship the Lord. You know, as the worship team gets ready, let's remember that this is a celebration of the goodness of God. You know, everything he did for us and continues to do is just a reminder of how good and how much he loves us.
James, you ready? All right, count us in.
Good.
side. Hallelujah. Come on, church.
Jesus, your name is power, breath, the living water, such a marvelous mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I say, praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Let's see verse 3 again. Filled with wonder. Church, scream that name.
Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come.
The Lord has put something in your heart, and He wants you to sing. Maybe what He put in your heart is just for you, but just declare it. Remember that there's power in our words. Let's speak in agreement with what God says. Let's declare those things so that they come to pass in our lives.
Everyone needs compassion. Salvation, Lord, it flows not just for eternal life, but for all things that pertain to life and godliness, for the abundant life in this world, Lord, that your salvation is complete.
Yes.
It is total. We thank you for that, Lord. Jesus. Jesus. The kids have already gone downstairs, maybe? They already sneaked down? Good morning. I'm not Nathan. He is traveling this morning. Surprise! Yeah, minus the facial hair. Let me figure out how this works. Is the mic on? Oh, yep, I hear. Okay. Well, since everybody already preached my message this morning during the testimonies, I think we'll just, you know, call it a day and go. I'm just kidding. It's just amazing, though, that, I mean, God knows, doesn't he? He just knows. He knows what we need. He knows where we're at. And we all go there together, it seems like, which is good and bad, right? It's good. It's good because we can come together. And so as I was thinking about and praying about what the Lord wanted to say this morning, you know, all through the Bible, there's types and shadows, right? There's natural patterns that God tries to use throughout the Bible to explain heavenly spiritual realities. And a lot of times God reveals himself in threes. There's one God, but he reveals himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We're one person, but likewise we have a body, we have a soul, and we have a spirit. Well, I didn't realize that when I was going to study threes, I was going to end up with three messages this morning. So I kind of have three messages, but we'll see how it all comes together. I want to talk about the three heavens, the three temples, and the three arcs this morning. And what does the number three represent? Three represents perfection and unity. And I think as a body and in these end times, perfection and unity is exactly what we need. So let's go to the Word of God this morning and seek perfection. Let us seek unity together. Heavenly Father, reveal your truth this morning. Have your way, Lord, that you've called us out, Lord. I'm stepping out in faith, Lord. I have all these scriptures. I'm going to let you lead, Lord. Lead us and guide us. Reveal your truth for this body in Jesus' name. All right. I prepared all these notes, and I kind of feel like I need to scrap them, but I'm struggling. You know, at Eastern Gate House of Prayer, we're talking about stepping out, right? Stepping out in faith and letting God do something he's never done, like making me throw away my notes. So I'm just going to start with the heavens, right? We all know that there's three heavens. And in Genesis chapter 1, God, on day 1, God said, let there be light, and there was light. He divided the light from the darkness and called it day and night. On day 2, he said, let there be firmament in the midst of the waters, and God divided the waters, and he called firmament heaven. And on day 3, God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together, and he created the earth. And on day four, God said, let there be light in the firmament of heaven, and the celestial heaven, outer space, was divided, it was created. So likewise, the earth realm, right, the earth realm is the physical realm, right? It's the world we can see, the world we touch, the world we, the cursed earth that we have to labor and toil to gather. We have the celestial heaven, right, that is the area of the seen and the unseen. You know, we can see part of it, but as we get technology, we know that there's so much more we have never even seen. It goes beyond. And it's also that place in the spirit realm, the air, right? The prince of the power of the air. It's that in-between place. It's the place that is located between this earth and the third heaven, which is where God dwells, right? The third heaven. Peter was taken up to the third heaven, where God's throne is. And, you know, the rain comes from heaven, waters the earth, the stars in the heaven and their constellations. And in the highest heaven is where God dwells. So now I'm going to just go quickly to the three temples, or the temple, right? So there's three temples. There's three parts to the temple. There's a picture of the tabernacle of Moses in the back. We have the tabernacle in the wilderness, right, that Moses created. We have the great temple that Solomon built in Jerusalem. And then we are the third temple, the body of Christ, right? Know ye not that you are the temple. Tabernacle was the first one. The first temple was built by Moses in the wilderness. Tabernacle means tent, a place of dwelling or a sanctuary. It's a sacred place where God would meet with his people. For the first time, God choosing a place where he said, I'm going to dwell in your midst, and I will have a relationship with you here. And in order for that to happen, he required complete obedience. They needed obedience in how to build the tabernacle. If there was anything that they didn't go exactly by the blueprint God gave them, it wasn't going to work. God wouldn't come and abide there. And it may seem like the rules were cumbersome, but he was trying to help them understand, it's not about you, it's about me. I'm telling you what you have to do to get to me. And this also means that every detail in the tabernacle is a revelation of God himself. He's telling us where he chooses to dwell. Make a sanctuary for me and I will dwell among them, God says in Exodus 25. Make this tabernacle and all its furnishings exactly like the pattern I will show you. And then I will dwell among the Israelites and be their God. They will know that I am the Lord their God who brought them out of Egypt so that I might dwell among them. And so God did dwell among his people. It was a mobile tent. This tabernacle, every time they moved, they had to pack it up and move it. I can't even imagine. I mean, we all know how hard moving is today, right? You move and you got years worth of stuff. I mean, these guys traveled the wilderness for 40 years and had to pack up the tabernacle and put it together exactly the same way. There were rules about how everything was packed and everything was moved. But God wasn't just in the tabernacle. He showed himself, right? He showed himself the pillar of fire by night and the cloud by day. This was the visual tabernacle, right? This was the physical tabernacle where God revealed himself. So I would call this a parallel to the first heaven, right? So, because every time God does it, he reveals something more, something higher. There's a higher form. The first tabernacle was like the first heaven, right? It's the natural one. You could touch, you could see. And part of the, I'll quickly go through some of the, what I call the things I think that are relevant for us today. The Eastern Gate. There was only one way to enter the tabernacle, and it was the Eastern Gate. And it's no coincidence that our prayer and worship sessions are called the Eastern Gate, House of Prayer. It's the one way you get through to enter into God's presence. There's one door. Jesus is that door. We know that. It was 30 feet wide. And his courts, right? There were three courts in the tabernacle. The courtyard, the outer court, the holy place, and the Holy of Holies. And God tells us how to enter his presence. In Psalm 100, verse 4, he says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. So when we enter in today, we don't have to worry about the rules of the original tabernacle, but it's the same today. The outer court was a place where those seeking forgiveness could come and offer up their sacrifices. The holy place, there was a tent inside of the walls, right? There was the walls, and there was a tent inside, and there were two places inside the tent. The first was the holy place. And this holy place was only seen by the priests. It was not seen by all the people. So it was unseen and seen. And then the Holy of Holies was only seen by the one high priest one day a year. So I would call this the unseen place. Now, when you entered into the outer court, there's all these different tools or, you know, altars or different things in the court. So when you first entered the outer court, there's the brazen altar, which is, of course, the place of sacrifice. Then you have the brazen laver, which is the bowl of water, the basin of water, where they would have to wash and be cleansed. Now, that's obviously a picture of the sacrifice required to come to God, covered by the blood of Jesus, the blood sacrifice that was required, and the cleansing of the water of the word. But I would also say that's also the new birth, right? Before we can enter into the holy place, we have to be born again, right? And Jesus was our access to be born again and to go into that holy place. And then you entered into the fold of the tent, into the holy place. And inside the holy place, there were three more instruments. The golden candlestick, or the menorah. It was a single candlestick up to the front in the middle, and then three coming out on each side, made of one solid piece of gold. And, of course, it represents Jesus and the church, right? The candlestick, as Nathan's talked about a lot, is representative of the church. It represents Jesus and the church, and the one piece of pure gold is representative of perfection. The Jesus has perfected the church. And that is the only source of light in the holy place. And they are to be lit all the time. They're to be remain light all the time. The table of showbread, also called the bread of his presence. There were always 12 loaves of bread on this table of showbread. And that represents the 12 tribes of Israel. Okay? And they would change those every day on the Sabbath. They were not allowed to cook or eat. And so the priests would feast on the showbread for that week on the Sabbath day that they had prepared during the week, and then would change it each week. And we know that Jesus is the bread of life. And lastly, there's the altar of incense, and this is right before the door. It's set right in front of the door to the Holy of Holies, and it is a symbol of prayer and interception, the prayers and intercession of God's people going up as a sweet fragrance to God. And you know, as we know in Isaiah, God said, "My house will be called a house of prayer for all the nations." Next, there's the Holy of Holies. And this is the most holy place, the inner room, hidden behind the veil. The Holy of Holies represents heaven itself, God's dwelling place. And there's a veil, right, that's separated. God had to be separated. Sinful man couldn't have access to him. There was this thick veil, this curtain that was hung. The barrier between man and God, showing that the holiness of God could not stand, right? Sinful man cannot stand in the presence of a holy God. And inside, behind the veil, was the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat. And the Ark was a chest made of acacia wood, and it was overlaid with pure gold. And inside of it, there were three things inside of it: the pot of manna, Aaron's staff that budded, and the two stone tablets, which were the Ten Commandments. And over the top, to cover it, was the mercy seat, right? It was the cherubims, it was the cover, it was the lid. And that's what the blood was sprinkled on once a year. And the three articles that God placed inside the ark were the three, they represented the three most embarrassing and disgraceful events in the history of the Israelites. Now, if you wanted to memorialize something in the most holy place, wouldn't that just kind of defy logic that you put the most horrible things in there? But our God is not always a logical God, right? He covers those things. He takes our most horrible, most ridiculous, most sinful moments, and he puts them in the ark, and he covers them, never to be seen again. Washed, redeemed by the power of the blood. The pot of manna. God had provided this bread-like food for the Israelites, and they grumbled and they complained. They whined because they were tired of eating the same bread from heaven. Oh, boy. You know, talking about dieting earlier, I mean, I might get a little sick of eating tuna salad, you know, for 40 years, but it was miraculous, you know. And Aaron's budding staff, they complained because God picked Aaron, They thought that, well, he's Moses' brother. It was a favorite. They were whining and complaining. So God said, all right, everybody put your rods down. And God affirmed Aaron's selection. He chose Aaron. It wasn't because he was Moses' favorite. It wasn't because whatever. God chose him. And they rebelled against his decision. And last was the stone tablets. God had chosen the Israelites as his special people. And for the Israelites to qualify for that distinction, God had demanded one thing, that they obey his law, the Ten Commandments. All that you have done, Lord, we will do. And we know how long that lasted. About the time they finished saying it. Over and over again, they violated God's holy law. And he said, I will cover it. Right? And the atonement cover. Every year, the high priest would enter the Holy of Holies. He would have to prepare himself. He would take all this time to prepare himself to go in and sprinkle the blood. And if the high priest was righteous in God's sight, they would have favor the whole year. And if he was unholy, horrible year. They were cursed. They lost every battle. The crops failed. It was a horrible year. Now, the second temple was much like the first temple, only it was on a much grander scale. Solomon built this massive stone structure. I mean, you guys have seen pictures of the temple in Israel. It was beautiful to behold. He said that, you know, he wrote to the kings and he said, we must build a temple worthy of our God. And every extravagance, everything was put in there, but it was just a building. And when Jesus came, what'd he say? You've made my father's house a den of thieves. It was just a building. And not even everybody was allowed in the building, right? It was just the priests in there. It was supposed to be a place where more people could enter in, where there could be more interaction, but it was that place where there was confusion and chaos, and it turned into something it was never intended to be. And that temple was destroyed, right? That temple was destroyed. And now the third temple, the greatest revelation of the place where God wants to dwell is us. He's chosen to dwell in a temple not made with human hands. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. He has chosen to make his tabernacle, his habitation within man. The greatest mystery of us becoming one with him. So now I'm going to switch gears. I'll try and tie this all together at the end. Switch gears and talk about Noah and the ark. We've been talking a lot about the river. And you know, I was praying. I watched the movie Noah. I don't know if anybody watched the movie Noah. I know that, you know, it's a worldly version. There were some things where I thought, oh, no. And then there were some things where I was like, well, if someone doesn't know the story, if someone doesn't know. But there were a couple things that struck me about the movie that I think just were visual reminders. You know, when we think about, I guess I never thought about how the flood happened, you know. The flood came, the earth broke open and great geysers came up and the water from heaven. Well, there'd never been rain on the earth yet. So there's Noah. God says, build an ark. I'm going to flood the earth. And Noah's like, what's a flood? What's an ark? I'm going to rain down from it. What's rain? He says, build it. He says, okay, I'll build it. Now, why did God pick Noah? He didn't pick him because he was a good guy. Because he was, you know, behaving. He picked him because he had pure blood. If we go back to, let's go to Genesis chapter. Let's go to Genesis chapter 6, verse 1. Let's just read a little bit about the days of Noah. And this is something I'd never paid, and, you know, the movie had, like, stone giants. I don't know what that was all about, but just a visual depiction. We'll do verses 1 through 6. And it came to pass, when man began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, the sons of God, not the sons of man, the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh. Yet his days shall be 120 years. And there were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was an evil, was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he made man on earth, and it grieved him at his heart. So the sons of God, those were those fallen angels that were dwelling on the earth. The angels were breeding with the daughters of man. And there was this tainted race. There was this evil thing going on. And God grieved. He's like, this is not what I created. And we are not, I mean, you can go back to chapter 5. We're not very many generations from Adam and Eve. We're like, what, 5, 6 generations out? And we're breeding with angels, and we've got giants, and we've got all this craziness going on. And God said, I am grieved I ever made man. But then he found Noah, who had followed God's commands, which were not to marry angels, you know. And he looked upon him, and we know from what the Bible tells us of what happened on the ark, that it was not because he was a good man, because he was perfect in his behavior. It's because his blood was pure. God saved the earth through one man's blood, his line, right? Now also, there was another ark. Let's see. There was another ark. An ark that was a little basket that they put a little baby named Moses in. That was an ark, right? There was an ark that the Pharaoh's daughter found, and Moses was saved. There's also the Ark of the Covenant, right? And that's where the law was. There's also an ark in the temple, and it's what held the scrolls, the Torah. So I would say, can we agree that the ark is the carrier of the word of salvation? It's a dwelling place for the word. It's a dwelling place for the word of salvation. So I would say it's a carrier of grace. The ark is a carrier of grace. And now, you and I are the arks. I woke up and I've been praying about this. I'm like, well, this doesn't make any sense. He's like, you are the ark. I'm like, whoa. Whoa, you are the ark. You are the Savior. He said, do not, and the scripture came to mind, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Do you understand that you are the only boat that can save a drowning and dying world? And Kirk Cameron, there was actually a Kirk Cameron quote, I don't know if he actually said it, but I saw it on Facebook, so it's real, it's true. Kirk Cameron said, if you had the cure for cancer, would you share it, or would you keep it to yourself? You have the cure for death. You have the cure for death. You know the cure for death.
That's exactly right.
And why are we so bashful about sharing it? You could be the only chance someone has to not drown and be destroyed in this new world coming. We are the arks. We are the carrier of that grace. And I thought, woo! And God says, do you not know who you are? Do you not know who you are? Because just like Tammy says, it's no longer you who live. It's Christ who lives. And isn't it funny that if we could travel from Genesis all the way to Revelation, in his throne room in Revelation chapter 4, what's over the throne? The rainbow. What's the rainbow? It's a covenant. That I will not destroy the earth with water again, but he will destroy the earth. His glory will cover the earth, and his glory will destroy the earth. So we have to be able to stand and withstand his glory. And I had I had one of my little mini visions that I see sometimes. And I was asking God, I was trying to understand the mystery of one God in three. I was praying for revelation. And I always see and talk to Jesus very easily because he's a man. And I was like, show me the Father. Show me the Father. And so God said, all right, Jesus. And it was the veil. It was rent. And Jesus was like, all right, you want to go in. Let's go. And I literally, the second my toes crossed the threshold on my face, it was like, whew, talk about diminishing. Like, I was like, I can't even look at his little toe. I can't even look at his little toe. And I was like, Lord, the weight of your glory is so intense. How are we going to be able to stand? How are we going to be able to minister? And I prayed, and I came back, and again, I had that same vision. And this time, Jesus wrapped himself around me like a garment, and we walked in. We walked in because that wasn't me. We can't stand in God's glory. We weren't created to stand in God's glory. We are created to be one with Christ, who is God's glory, who is our covering, who is our access to go boldly. Oh, I'm getting goosebumps with my goosebumps. That is it. I thought I wanted to see God. Okay, well, guess what? You are God. I am God. I am one with him. Not that I have any power or authority. I no longer live. But when I walk, when I speak, I am God. I am Jesus Christ. I am the ark. I am the carrier, the purveyor of grace and truth in this world. And we have to understand, Nathan said it so well, he said it, that in order for God's glory to fill this earth, there has to be an ascension. We have to be able to rise up, and God has to descend, and together we fill the earth. We are the headwaters of rivers of living water that are to fill the earth. Rivers of living water flow from our bellies. Now, I don't know if anybody's been to the headwaters of the Mississippi. That is the most unimpressive thing I've ever seen. I mean, you want to talk about like a little trickle, some little rocks and a little stream. Like a two-year-old could jump over it. Unimpressive. But that is the headwaters of the Mississippi River, the most mighty river in the Western Hemisphere. You can see it from outer space. That is a mighty rushing river, so do not despise the day of small beginnings. If you are a little babbling brook, you know what? Downstream, that is a mighty rushing river that changes and brings life wherever it will flow. You don't know where it goes next. You don't know, but you have to let it, you have to let it fly, let it loose, right? We are to let loose of those waters. And what is the water? It's the Word. It's the Word. The Word is going to fill this earth. It's not the waters of Noah. It is the Word of God that brings life wherever it goes. It is that cleansing, healing water. Oh, that we drink. Oh, and we are satisfied. We will never thirst again. So why don't we let it loose? What's holding us back? Well, sometimes this world, whew, it can get hard, can get dry, those long droughts. Sometimes unbelief can dry out our hearts, can dry up those rivers. Nothing faster than fear, doubt, and unbelief will dry up those rivers. You will be thirsty and looking in all the wrong places to quench it. The water of the Word, it makes our ground soft. When we soak, when we feast on that Word, when we drink deeply, worship is soaking in His presence. When we worship together, it is glorious. It's wonderful. I look forward to coming here every time the doors are open. My husband's always joking. Every time the doors open, you got to go, yes, I do. Because if you want to stay married to me and you want to live with me, I got to go. People at work are like, go to church. Go on, go on. Go on, go to church. You're okay. We're good. We'll live without you tonight. I mean, it does something. It changes us. It changes us, and it helps us remember God is so much bigger. God is so much more. And you know what? Sometimes we need a jackhammer. Sometimes we just got to push through and jackhammer, 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 keep pushing through. And that is our prayers. That is the intercession. That is the prayers of other believers. You know, we talked about the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Yes. Not the one-time prayer. Not the one-time think about it and beg on it. It's speak the word, God. Speak the word, God. Your word says, God. Your word says, God. I am convinced your word says. Speaking to that situation,
yes.
Jesus didn't ask. He told. He said, open your eyes.
Yes.
He said, rise. He said, be healed.
Yes.
He didn't ask.
Right.
We don't have to ask.
Right.
We got to speak the word,
amen.
Knowing. And pretty soon, great rushing rivers. Pretty soon, it comes flowing out of here, and it's swimming, right?
Yes.
And so I said, go float your boat, right? You got to have water if you want to float that boat. We're building an ark for what? We've come together, and, you know, they're us individually, right? There's the mystery of us individually, one with God. There's the mystery of all of us together, our one body,
yeah.
The body of Christ, the physical, literal, tangible, I can see it, body of Christ.
Yeah.
That is how His glory is going to cover the earth. That's exactly how it has to be. And so, Don, I know that you talked about it a little more today, but, you know, we're in a battle whether we like it or not. There's spiritual warfare. Now, if I take that temple and I flip it up, right, I've got the outer court, the earth. I've got the holy place, the second heavens, right, the air. I've got that third, I've got the holy of holies, that's the heavenly realm. Well, what is between this earth and heaven getting through? It's the air, the prince of the power of the air. Well, I got news for you. He's been defeated.
Yes.
He has no teeth. He's already got his teeth pulled. He had all of his weapons destroyed. All he can do is whisper in your ear. He can come and he can give you, he can whisper, like you said, God's not going to do it. He didn't do it that one time. That one time, that thing, oh, it's, you know, but you did this, and now God's not going to, who are you that God's going to bless you? Who are you that God's going to use you? This, oh, God doesn't heal everybody who has cancer. You know, you got the ache, the pain, oh my gosh, it's a tumor, you know, and all those thoughts, they come. Those letters in the mail, those bank statements, whatever it is, they come. But the word of God is forever.
Yes.
And that is our battle. What are we going to believe? The enemy comes to steal your belief. Faith is a gift. He cannot take your faith, but he can steal your belief. Because if you don't believe, you cannot activate your faith.
Right.
Those are gifts, right? All of those gifts of the Spirit, they are gifts. They're in you, in the Spirit that is within you, but we can't wait to activate them through our belief in them, to take a step and to open our mouths. It is the words that we speak that determine what happens in this world. That is the way God created it. He spoke it into existence, and that is the way it will be until there is no more earth and it passes away. It is the word that we speak. And you know what? Whether they're God's words or whether they're our words, they have power. And so like you said, Tammy, the first thing out of our mouth, Jesus. First thing out of my mouth, healing. First thing out of my mouth, everything I set my hand to prospers. First thing out of my mouth, me and my house shall be saved. You know, you get those phone calls, my house, my tent goes as far as I say it goes.
Exactly.
Second cousins, third cousins, by marriage, twice removed, that is my house.
Yes.
Me and my house will be saved.
Amen.
Everybody who comes under my roof is in my house. Everybody who is in the realm of my voice and in my Facebook, that is my tent.
Yes.
God said, enlarge your tent.
Yes.
Got to grow your family. You know, we have to keep sending that light forward. And so how do we do battle? What is the only weapon that we have? The sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God that comes out of his mouth. He gives us image after image of that word that comes out. Where's that? Hebrews 4:12. Roberto. Sorry. I was on a tangent. Go back to my scriptures. Hebrews 4:12. Okay. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So what is it between the second heaven and the third heaven? The body, soul, and spirit divides between what is soul and what is spirit. And once it divides and cuts through that air, heaven can descend to earth. It is the sword of the Spirit, the word of God. And the Lord also gave us clues, because what's in that holy place, right? He gave us clues how to do warfare by what he put in the holy place in the temple. The golden candlesticks, light, revelation. We're hooked up to the oil of his presence. We're hooked up to the word, the light that comes. We have to let our light shine. The table of showbread. Are you going to eat 12 loaves of bread all yourself? Are we to feed others? You know, we're to feed others. And it's also called the bread of his presence, right? The word of God. And the altar of incense, prayer and worship and intercession, filling that place with smoke, a sweet fragrance. The atmosphere changes when we pray. The atmosphere changes when we get revelation, when we feast on the word of God, when we feast on his presence. And once we know how to warfare, then we can, that's our ministry, right? That is the ministry in the presence of God. And the manifest presence of God is called the Shekinah. We sing a song about Shekinah glory. That is the manifest presence of God, the glory of God.
Yes.
1 Thessalonians 5:23 says, "And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, as in all of you," W-H-O-L-L-Y. "And I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." Romans 8:7 says, "Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can it be." There's a carnal mind that cuts us off. And it's basically anything that's against the word of God. So how do we know? We have to study in the word of God. The word of God is our victory. Revelation 19:11-16. Because remember, he hath raised us up together, and he's made us sit in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Revelation 19:11-16. "And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his heads were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name was called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he might smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." And at the end of that chapter, verse 21, "And the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceedeth out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh." Our enemies are destroyed utterly, totally, and completely by the word of God. They have no power. We speak the word for our own ears. We speak the word for our own ears sometimes. And once we're convinced, then we can speak the word for others, right? God wants us to understand the fullness and the completeness of our redemption. We are one with Christ. John 17:20-23. I'm going to pull Nathan out, and I'm wrapping up with these. Means another 20 minutes. John 17:20-23. John 17:20-23. "Neither pray," and this is Jesus praying for the body of believers, for all those that would follow. "Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them." Let me read that again. "And the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one." That they may be made perfect in one, "and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me." He's given us his glory. He's already given it to us, but we only know it when we are hidden in him, when we are truly hidden in him. Galatians 2:20. This is exactly what Tammy said earlier. "Notwithstanding, I have a few, Galatians, sorry. Oh, wrong one. That's Revelation 2:20. "And I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, in this body, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It's not me. I'm Suzanne / Jesus. My last name has changed. I have a new name. Romans 12, 5 through 6. So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and everyone members one of another, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the portion of faith. It's the mystery of all of us being one together. Not only are we one with Christ, we're one body. And we need every single member of that body for the true revelation of Jesus Christ to be brought forth. We need everybody to prophesy, to speak with divine unction. That's really all that means. Your testimonies are divine unction. Any worship, any songs, anything that comes forth, that is divine unction because you are one with Christ. Like Jesus, we need to find ourselves in the scripture. We are one with him. Jesus came, even as a small boy, he was in the temple. Finding himself. In Luke chapter 4, verses 16 through 21. Whoo, he shook things up with this one. Talk about pushing grace to its limits. Whoo, I am on the line today. But that's what we're to do. If it's not pushing it, if we don't, I mean, how else does it happen? And Jesus, he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. Now, if you don't know, the scriptures were read on certain days. This wasn't just like he looked for this scroll and found it. There's a certain scripture that's read on certain days. It's already pre-scheduled. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, and to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." That is for every one of us. That is for every one of us. We are to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. We are Jesus on this earth. We are the body of Jesus Christ on this earth. And we'll finish with this. Mark 16, verses 15 through 20. What were Jesus' last words to his disciple? Right? The Great Commission. Mark chapter 16, verses 15 through 20. And he said unto them, "Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe." Sound familiar? "In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. That's where we're at. Go forth. You are the temple of God, central to the life of the faith. You are the ark. You are the message, the purveyor, the carrier of grace. And we are Jesus, right? We are the body of Christ in this earth. So what really do we have to fear? What can come against us when we remember who we are, who God says we are, and find ourselves in the Word? We are so firmly rooted and grounded that nothing can shake us. And these signs shall follow us too. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Be blessed, and you are dismissed in Jesus' name.